So this is me. I'm going to talk about what everybody's talking about apparently this afternoon. It's a very well-formed panel. I'd like to thank Adam for putting together a bunch of different ideas and giving us some direction about the kinds of things to talk about. I'm going to talk about differential privacy in a repository structure. So it's going to contrast a bit with some of the talks you've seen before. Different types of things people want out of repositories. I'm thinking about particularly here about scientists. We had some talks all the way back in the morning about linkages to ICPSR, and there'll be some externalities and some compare and contrast to that talk, perhaps. But let me just go through who people are. This is me if you want contact details on the slides later. But these are all the people who really do a lot of the leadership work on this project. Many of them are in the room. It's a very, very large group of people. It's a very large interdisciplinary project. You'll see some of these people, Alex, talking about some of these projects. And the list actually really just goes on and on and on and on. So everybody's in there. Most of these people work in this literature. And I started off as a bit of a bridge between, say, people like this and people like Gary, who's more of a statistician. This project comes out of a very interdisciplinary approach. The goal was to sort of link theory work that was going on in computer science in differential privacy with statisticians who work in the social sciences, which is where I started off at the Institute for Quantitative Social Science, but also think about the legal and policy aspects of privacy. And also think about things that LaTanya thinks, very, very practical technologist approaches to how is technology is changing, is privacy changing? And think about, okay, how can we build toolkits that lean on theory, lean on the practicalities of technology, lean on the policy implications of privacy, but actually create tools that would be of use to quantitative social scientists. And this has been the sort of the nature of interdisciplinary work that between us, we all sort of agree on what the numbers are called, that's about it. So there's been a lot of my learning how computer science works, and a lot of our talking to computer scientists about what it is that scientists actually try to do with data. And by scientists, I mean a fairly narrow set. I mean particularly academic scientists who are working in the human sciences, so social scientists, health policy scientists, education policy scientists, those kinds of people. But if you understand the academic sciences, open data is increasingly the norm. It varies by discipline exactly how strong that norm is, but it is this foundational norm that if you write work, there should be ways that other people can critique that work within the original data that you ran. Okay, so there's this norm of that you should be able to replicate work. Work should extend to other data sets that come later. Progressive, expansive, scientific advance rests upon access to data. Okay, along with sufficient information for reproducible results. So that's great. And we've seen this replication crisis in the sciences lately, which is it's the best crisis to have, which is to say that people are carefully examining each other's work and seeing how often it fails, and using that to really create the foundation of what do we believe and what do we not believe as scientific results come through. And also, open science is the coinage of how people who create useful data sets get academic credit for them, because if nobody else can look at those useful data sets, then they're not gonna get cited. However, all of this runs up against, of course, all the problems that we know when this data becomes sensitive, and as the sort of ubiquity of sensors to monitor people, particularly in the human sciences, in ever increasing detail, we worry more and more about what's going to happen as these data sciences become, as they become more and more invasive. And we know that there aren't simple solutions here. Okay, so anonymization just really doesn't work. Aggregated statistics seem to the novice to have some measure of privacy to them, but there's really, really simple attacks there. Fingerprinting attacks, no guarantees here. And then, you know, we mentioned before that people who do models say, oh, my model is not about a person, it generalizes, therefore it has privacy. But, you know, even statistical models, machine learning models, they can all leak individual level information, particularly with time variance. Okay, so what we're going to try to build here is a way a curation system, and I'll explain this in more detail, but this is the highest level graph, a curation system such that we can store data that the scientific community wants to make open to reanalysis, to secondary analysis, to replication, to questioning a study's results with some other a way of understanding it. Okay, somebody owns a data set, they collect a data set, they've published from it, they'd like to make that data available to the scientific community. We're going to put it behind a curator. There's going to be an interface layer so that people who now need to look at that data can't see the raw data themselves, but they themselves can say, oh, I really like this person's work. I see his data sitting in the curator. I'd like to ask some questions of it in order to see whether I actually believe this results. What if they'd done this other little thing? Or what if I tweak their theory a little bit? Or what if I look at a different subpopulation? Okay, so make queries. Make new queries or possibly extend, reuse the data in a way that was not anticipated by the original author. Okay, or maybe just learn exactly what that data is about. Okay, because you know sometimes you just don't really understand what the data is from the things that have so far been published from it. Okay, so how do we build this system? And this is a very general system. So we spoke earlier in the last talk about, and in talks before this, about how hard it is, about how many of the applications in differential privacy are can be extremely successful, but also extremely tied to one particular type of analysis. Really highly tuned, the algorithms really, really focused or built out to solve one particular use case really, really well. But we're going to work here with a repository system, which I'll talk about. It's too many slides away. Where we really don't know where the next data set's going to come in. We're going to work with a group called the Dataverse, which is like ICPSR. It's a repository of primarily human subject data. It's got about 60,000 data sets in the largest one. There's 20 instances of it across the world, and different universities store different types of data in them. But you never know what the next data set is going to be, and you never know what the next analyst is going to want of that. So we're trying to build a very, very general purpose tool that might not be well tuned to any specific problem, but will give fairly robust generalized answers to the multiplicity of types of data sets and questions that might be of interest to the next data analyst. Okay, so we're going to build a curator model here. Slightly more, I don't know, it's got more arrows and letters and numbers and things, but we're going to place the data into secure storage and have an interface layer called a term of art here, the curator. Outside users, so depositors dropped off the data. Outside users can ask queries of the curator who has access to the raw data, and they'll get back answers, but those won't be exact answers. Those will be answers that have been generated by mechanisms which use differential privacy and have these mathematical guarantees that no matter what combination of questions I might ask, I can't leak individual level information. Okay? No matter whether I difference them or I'm really clever or these users are, say, attackers asking multiple questions that they're thinking of in some clever way to re-identify individuals or their information in the data set, the curator is going to only give back differentially private answers. Generally, that's going to mean giving back answers that have precisely tuned, calculated amounts of noise so as to mask the contribution that any one individual in the data set could have made to that answer. Okay, so for example, whether I am in the data set or I'm not in the data set, if there's a certain amount of noise I'm going to be adding, the noise is such that these two distributions are very, very close, so that I can't tell if I'm in the the data set in the repository is the blue data set that does not have me or the red data set that does have me, and if I can't even tell if I'm in the data set, because the distributions are so close, then I certainly can't learn anything about my values. Would I be in the were it that I was in the data set? Okay, and just talk a little bit more about the project background here. This is one piece of a large system of tools. I pointed before to all this interdisciplinary work where there's many different groups at Harvard all collaborating, and at MIT, and at other universities. And we're one mechanism by which somebody comes along with a data set, they collect data with consent from subjects, they build a data set, then they go to Dataverse and say, okay, I would like to make this data, I'd like to archive it, I'd like to put it in the repository, I'd like to say this data actually exists, you can rerun analyses in it. And then one mechanism by which the outside world might gain access to that data set is through this differentially private curator. It's not the only mechanism by which we think they'll get access to the data. And I'll talk about how we sort of tweak the curator system to actually work in practice in just a little bit. But here I want to front load my big picture questions to make sure I get to them. And then I'll go into some specifics about the actual things that we've built and show you some fancy stuff. Sort of in terms of practicality and questions of implementation, I got three questions that I want to highlight. And one is probably the most germane for this audience. And these are the things that we sort of learned, that these are the areas where what existed in the literature when we started working on this project, or when I came into this project certainly, which wasn't quite the start, we saw was sort of missing in order for a system to work for scientists. Okay, so a lot of the literature is built up on these ideas that you're asking a counting query of a sample data set, and you want to get an answer that's very, very close to the sample truth. But that's generally not what statisticians are interested in. They're generally interested in inferring something about some other population. And the rules of inference and the things you need to know in order to make valid inferences about populations from sample data and not get sample-specific answers require understanding of error in estimates, understanding of uncertainty, that is, what can you say about the degree of uncertainty between the sample answer and the population answer, that aren't necessarily amenable to some of the point predictions that differential privacy often gives. Pretend this answer is a plug-in estimate and now use it as if it's the truth and go forward with it. So these are areas that we've tried to work a lot to build, that lots of researchers in our group have worked on to try and express what is the error, what is the distribution that differential privacy is drawing from in a particular case, and say, I'm not just going to give you an answer and say it's differentially private, but it's an answer that's come from this distribution. So here's a distribution that reflects the error that comes with that answer. Be conscious of that error going forward. Build that into your statistical models. Other people do that, obviously, too, but that's been a focus. And expressions of uncertainty. So it's not enough to just say, here's the mean, or here's the difference of means, or here's the regression coefficient, but can you also do hypothesis tests on these things? And so building out p-values, trying to understand what the uncertainty of an answer is, how confident you can be in that answer, that's definitely somewhere. Those are areas where differential privacy as a literature really needs to advance to work well for scientists. Those have been focuses of our research, and I just want to say that regardless of how much effort we've put into it, it's an area that the literature needs to continue to press on. And then maybe some more obvious things, which is, of course, trying, when you're building a pragmatic system for actual scientists, trying to explain this is what epsilon means. I realize everybody's going to shake their head and go, yes, I realize that you need to know how to set epsilon. But it's one of these things that I think we're all willing to sort of side skirt for a while. And then in any practical system, the first question when you try to explain to a user and say, I'm not going to make you an expert in differential privacy, but I'm going to give you some guarantees and I want you to use the system in order to get the privacy protection that you want. The first question is going to be, okay, so what is this damn epsilon thing? So how do you communicate epsilon? How do you skill up a user so that they don't have to be a cryptographer or a computer science theorist in order to use this stuff, but still get the privacy protections that they want? In the same way that, say, as a statistician, I don't learn the chipset of my machine, but I do know some matrix algebra, right? I don't need to know the mathematics of differential privacy to understand how it works. And then obviously, if I was to push on the DP literature, I would say, well, and also the kinds of scientists we work with, these are the things they care about. These are the models that they care about. And to differing degrees, these are holes in the literature. How do you deal with missing data? That's a big pragmatic concern. If you're interested in causal analysis and matching, if you want to know not just what are relationships in the variable, but can I prove that things have a causal effect? These non-parametric methods are very heavily used in the biosciences and in the social sciences, and they're largely absent from the differentially private literature, which is great. That means we got lots of fun things to work on, but I'm going to encourage other people. I'm going to evangelize. I'm going to say other people should work on them too. And then obviously things like regression and optimization. These are things the literature has addressed, but they're not often tested at the scale of data sets that we see people actually using, right? So yes, there exist algorithms that are differentially private and do regression and do maximum likelihood, And they scale, and if you've got millions and millions of observations, you may be able to run a model with 5 or 10 parameters in it, but in the scale of data sets of tens of thousands, the performance can be fairly low. So pushing on the constants, that kind of boring work that isn't generally always of interest in theorists. So let me say, not only do I think people should do this work, but ever so quickly, we have been trying to do this work at different levels of success. So when I say we should write pedagogical materials, that is, we should, as a literature, differential privacy really needs to be able to communicate what this thing is without turning people into mathematicians. Been some good work in this group trying to write a non-technical primer for differential privacy. This has been, I remember talking at the beginning of this project, what do we need to communicate to scientists? We need some pedagogical material that doesn't require a great degree of skill. And it's really fortunate that my daughter was born right when I joined this project, because when anybody asks me her age, I can just think, how long have I been in this project? And then I remember her age, and I hopefully will never leave the project, because then that will fail. But now I know that she's going to be 4 soon. So it's taken about 4 years for these authors to work on this project. This is some idea. This is a standard missingness map. How do you deal with this? How do you make queries on data when you don't even know what n is? Or n highly varies across observations. Some regression solutions that I can point to that we've been working on, getting very, very reasonable differentially private regressors out of data over time. Here, this is Pew data. Work on differentially private causal analyses of policy experiments in India. I'm really blowing through this due to the shortness of time. Ways of getting standard errors of means, and not just the means, the points themselves, by using differentially private implementations of the bootstrap mechanism. So these are areas that, so I'm trying to, in quick graphical ways, say, these are areas that we're working on in this project, but there's so much work to do here. If any of these interest you, please. There's so many open problems. However, questions in the other direction. Okay, so what is it that the scientists have to do differently? It's not just about the theorists not solving the right problems. Really, I would say from building a tool that we hope to work in practice, you really also have to communicate to the scientists and tell them that their workflow is going to change substantially. Okay, scientists, particularly quantitative social scientists, they're trained from day one. The first thing you should do is stick your hands in the data. You should immerse yourself in the data. You should look at a table of the data, make sure you understand what it looks like. Look at some histograms of it. Look at some scatter plots. Really immerse yourself in the raw data. Well, that's not going to happen. Okay, and trying to convince somebody that aspect of their training they don't really need, that they can maybe explore the data through other mechanisms, that they can explore the data through metadata, that they can explore the data through statistical summaries, is uncomfortable. It's a changing moment in talking to scientists who want to deal with privacy. They're also, as statisticians, we're really, really trained to push down on the amount of error in our answers. Right? Like, normally you have the same data set, and the reason why I get to publish out of it 15 years after you get to publish out of it is because I thought of a different statistical technique that has lower error than you did, so I can observe a smaller magnitude change than you ever did. But standard errors really go up in this literature, so people are uncomfortable with saying, wait a second, if the standard error goes up by if it doubles, then you're basically saying I've lost, 3/4 of my data effectively or something. You obviously get pushback from that. And also, we're trained to reuse data in imaginative ways and keep going back to the data and thinking of other ways to ask questions. And other data is a finite resource, so how do you keep asking new imaginative questions from these data sets? But obviously, if we're thinking about a privacy loss budget, this idea that data sets may be closed when epsilon is exhausted is very uncomfortable. There's also things that repositories don't think about. So in trying to build a system that works with repositories are not used to thinking about whether their sources of randomness are cryptologically secure. Or how to store epsilons, those kinds of things. How to worry about whether transformations that are occurring in their data sets might leak information. Or even if, I don't have this up here, whether revealing the types of the variables in the data set itself can potentially leak information. Anyway, so let me talk about our system and its approach. I'll give a quick 5-minute demo. I think I've got 5 minutes left. Great. Our approach is, again, to have a robust, generalized system where we don't know what the next data set is, but we expect a scientist to be using it. So they're gonna do those kinds of inferential questions. Not necessarily, you know, they don't want necessarily an answer that has low error, particularly if they're doing causal. You know, if they're interested in causal questions, they might not care about reducing mean squared error in the sample data. They just want to reduce bias, which is, you know, only one half of that, right? But coming up with methods that have sort of generalized use across scientific applications, facilitating exploratory data analysis. So we're really focused on how can you get a user who comes to the repository to learn about the data and understand what the data is, even if they don't have access to the raw data, because that replaces this idea that scientists are used to immersing their hands in the data, and also is going to allow this idea that we have of tiered access. And this is the structural departure, I think, of our system from many other systems, which is we don't expect differential privacy to be the last step. We expect it to be an intermediate exploratory step. We have a repository of a large set of data sets, and what we've learned is that an enormous amount of actual physical man hours goes into intermediating between sensitive data and the real world. Okay, so projects that create lots of data, health science projects in the medical school, the population center at Harvard, the entities that own the MOOC data that comes out of Harvard edX, they all have full-time staffers, often multiple staffers, and they're just there to field queries. Somebody wants to know, oh, does your data set have enough people who are like this so that I could run a study and get this grant? And they have people who will say, I'll check and I'll give you an answer, but I'm not going to show you the raw data. And obviously, you know, you cut me in for a piece of that grant when you get that grant in the future. But the ability to automate that, because what we've seen is that, or what we've been told pretty repeatedly, is that somewhere between 10 and 20% of these queries pan out. And 80% of these queries are like, oh, I didn't realize that's what the data was. That's not the data I need. People are searching through data and doing this labor-intensive process of trying to poke, sometimes going through the entire IRB process, and then finding out, oh, well, wait, I thought there were more people who lived in California than this. This data is of no use to me, or people who have this disease, or whatever it is that you're looking for. So how do you let somebody learn what the data is in order to say, maybe if we trust people, go through that IRB process, or then contact the staff member? So our tier of access is to use differential privacy as a way of automating the exploration of the data, the understanding of the data, but then possibly when people really need access to that data, possibly going through the standard mechanisms that already exist, that is, going through an IRB process, getting access eventually at the end of this to the raw data. Okay, so our model, our software is a system of four pieces. I'll show you a demo of the budgeter, which is only one of four pieces here. We use a repository called Dataverse, which is a lot like ICPSR. We've been building an open source R library with all the underlying differentially private code. We have an interface for displaying the differentially private results and trying to communicate uncertainty, which we use. We use this thing called Two Ravens that you feel free to ask me about any of these other systems. I'm going to talk about the budgeter, though, because it's the most directly linked to the kinds of things people are talking about today. And this is a way that an analyst can divide an epsilon differentially private budget across answers, across statistics that they would like to make available. Okay, so here's the workflow. Somebody comes to Dataverse, they say, I've got a private data. They go into this budgeter and say, here's some information I'd like to make available to the general public. Then differentially private releases are written into a summary file that people can then explore, and possibly they might be able to ask some additional queries themselves. Let me show you that in operation. Here's Dataverse. ICPSR is in Michigan, Dataverse is in 21 places all over the world, but not quite every continent. So if anybody knows of a repository in Africa that needs a Dataverse instance, please tell me. Let me see. Here's an architecture diagram that might be useful for answering questions, but let me just see if this will run. Looks like it will run for me today. Maybe. Okay. Okay, so here's our system. If somebody is saying they want to make differentially private answers available to the next researcher to come along, they're going to get this two-page summary of what differential privacy is. How do you explain to them what epsilon is? That's a difficult question, but we have these summary stories. If this story sounds like your data, then these might be possible epsilon and delta values that would be applicable for you. Okay, so try and find a stylized story that fits your scenario. Tell us maybe what an epsilon and a delta are, or also this will segue into things that Alex is going to talk about. Maybe you go through an interview process that tells you what your epsilons are. Okay, when we set epsilon and delta, here's my raw data. This is census data that census has told me they regret ever having released because it does actually seem much more private than they originally thought it was. So we're going to go through this interface and start saying, okay, these are the variables in my data set. Here are some statistics that I think would be of use to the next person to come along to learn what this data set is. So I'm going to release the distribution of ages. First, I'm going to release the mean. In order to release the mean through the Laplace mechanism, now the system's going to start asking me, okay, give me some metadata. Tell me what the bounds are so I can create ranges for this. As I start to accumulate statistics, on variables that I'm going to release and the metadata that I need in order to make the differentially private releases of those things, I'm going to build up a table on the right-hand side, and this table is going to have all the statistics that I'm going to release and a way of communicating what the error in those statistics will be at the epsilon that you've budgeted. Okay? How about 3 minutes and 39 seconds? Okay, thank you very much. It's a commitment mechanism. I can't take longer than that. Okay, so I'm building up statistics here. I'm going to release the gender, and that's a Boolean variable, so there's only one statistic available because that is the sufficient statistic. You can learn everything about a Boolean from its mean. I'm going to release a categorical variable, a histogram over the four types, which are racial characteristics. As I build this up, maybe I can even speed it up just a little bit. I can ask questions. Here's the two-page modal window that tries to explain what differential privacy is in as succinct a way as we are able to make up. I'm going to release statistics on marital status. We're also going to deal with missingness with a very simple way that just says, well, if something's missing, draw from its uniform distribution over its possible ranges, or give me a tighter distribution to draw from. And obviously, if that's not touching the data, that's not violating privacy here. And then on the right-hand side now, I'm building up these five statistics that I was going to release. One of them's not available yet because I was an idiot, and I didn't actually give all the metadata that was necessary in order to tell me about what this differentially private statistic will be, but now it's there. Okay. So I have an epsilon of 0.25 to spend right now. It's been divided equally across these five statistics, but that might not be a good division. So at these values of epsilon, the system is able to interpret that to the non-expert user to say, well, okay, here's the error that each of these statistics will have when they're released at epsilon of 0.05. And if you don't know what that error means, each of them has a question mark that we were cycling through that gives a one-sentence definition. Okay, error of the mean of 7.48 means that this particular statistic at this particular epsilon will be this many units in the original distribution from 0 to 100 away from the true mean with probability less than 0.95. I can change my parameters. I can invoke secrecy of the sample because this is 2,000 people out of California, but California's 39 million people. Then suddenly my epsilons are going to get really, really, really large, but that's kind of cheating, so okay, I won't do that. That's fine. Down here, I'm reserving budget for the next person who might come along. So I'm going to make some statistics generally available to everybody in the world. But there's a couple of people have talked about hierarchies of understanding. So the repository might trust people at different levels, or the person who owns the data might trust different people at different levels. It might be willing to extend additional epsilon to certain people if they follow a terms of use. And because I know them, or because they're in my department, or in my university, or maybe just because they have an ORCID ID or something like that, for some hierarchy, there's some additional level of epsilon I'm willing to grant to an individual so long as I trust them to sign a terms of use that they will not collaborate or collude with somebody else who has their own epsilon. So we've got this tiered model where people are agreeing to what do we said, semi-honest in some of the talks earlier, okay? And then eventually, I'm modifying these errors. If I didn't like the equipartition of epsilon, if I'm willing to create more error in some of the statistics than others, then the epsilons will be rearranged. And finally, with 9 seconds left, I'm going to, okay, well, I will spend these degrees of epsilon on these 5 statistics, can't go back when I press that button, and I'm done. Okay, at that point, I'm going to send the data set to the back end. It's going to generate differentially private releases. Your epsilon is spent. They're out there in the world. A metadata has been created. Okay? Any questions? Thank you.